You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja, and today we are talking to the just retired Chief Justice of Uganda, Bart Magunda Katurebe. My Lord, welcome to this show. You said last week when you were about to retire that you were retiring, but emphasized that you were going home. Yes. What does that mean?
It means I'm coming home and you have found me home. Meaning I have a home to retire to. And I'm happy to retire to my home. I feel satisfied that I have played my part and others can play their part and I can come home without any hesitation. And go to another aspect of my life, private life, social life. So that's really what it means to be home.
But with several statements that you've been making, some people felt that probably you were in a rush to get home. For example, about 3 years ago, you said you would leave at 70 years on the dot. Yes. And when you were handing over office, you urged public servants to retire when the time comes.
You see, you have to understand the context. It is not a question of being in a rush to go home. It's your home. You're not in a rush. You have to see you have been given a responsibility. And that responsibility is governed by the supreme law of the country. And the supreme law of the country is the Constitution. When I was appointed Chief Justice, the country was coming from a very strange period where we had gone for 2 years without a Chief Justice. And the matter was being litigated in the court. So you had a situation where the office of Chief Justice was being litigated upon in the courts over which he presides. It was a very unusual situation for the country. So what I emphasized from the beginning, I have been appointed when I'm already 65. The Constitution says, on reaching 70, you shall vacate. Those are not my words, the words of the Constitution. So I wanted to give confidence to the people I serve within the judiciary, to the country that had gone through the period of 2 years without a Chief Justice, that for me, when I reach 70, as the Constitution says, I shall obey the command of the Constitution. So that does not say you are anxious to retire and so on. It's simply to emphasize that I will abide by what the Constitution says.
But the law also gives you the leeway, 3 months, up to 3 months, to clear pending cases. And we've been reading in the media that you, just 2 weeks ago, you had cases to adjudicate.
No, that was a mistake by both the reporter and the office. As I explained to the reporter, I think, who had written that, it was a matter for the editor. We had a meeting, and the Supreme Court was going to have a session of something like 60 cases. So my colleagues were asking me if they could put me on some of the panels, and I was saying I cannot take on new matter when I have a very limited period. The Constitution says, as you said, pending matters. The only thing I could concede to help out, because I knew those 3 months, is to sit in an application. Because an application, you can decide it there, and then we can write the ruling within a matter of a week or two. But not an appeal, which takes a longer time to research and so on. But when they prepared the cause list, I found I had been put on two appeals, actually very big appeals. So I immediately called the head of the court, and she agreed. I said, there's no way I can be on an appeal, because it would be on condition, first, that I cannot write the judgment. Two, that whoever is writing the judgment must give us a guarantee that he will have a judgment ready for me to sign within 3 months. So we agreed that was not... Now, before the thing had been corrected, you people carried it all over the place that I had given myself two extra cases, which was, first of all, not true. Secondly, it could not be sustained because you cannot guarantee that I would hear those two big appeals, research them, right judgment, circulate the judgment, because experience shows that those type of cases usually take longer than that. So that was not true, and it was corrected, and I'm not in any case. What I have explained, the Constitution says the 3 months allowed you to finish any matters that may be pending before you. In other words, something you have started but is still pending. And there are only, I think, two or three matters where I sat on a panel, and there are, I think, criminal cases, all of them, where we discussed and somebody else is originating the draft. And some drafts have already been circulated, and when I go back to Kampala, I still have the time to finish those. Those are pending matters which answer the call of the Constitution. But the Chief Justice has two roles. There is the role of administration. Now, you can't say in administration that there is anything pending. Every day you have to make an administrative decision. Every day you are called for a meeting. Every day there are things to answer. Now, those are not matters that are pending, because you would now be taking on new things which now, in effect, you are perpetuating yourself. And so I made that decision. My interpretation is, as a judicial officer, I can complete those matters, but let the office of Chief Justice be taken over by someone who will take now day-to-day matters, because there are day-to-day matters in administration. And the Constitution says that when the position of Chief Justice is vacant, the Deputy Chief Justice shall be acting Chief Justice. That's the Constitution. So there's nothing strange that has happened.
Some of your colleagues in the judiciary think that probably the Constitution should be amended for the age limit of judges, 70 cap, be lifted, including your deputy.
Well, I have no problem with that. Let the debate start. If someone wants to amend the Constitution has provided that it can be amended. Bring the proposals before Parliament, let them be debated. If they say so, let it be. But I hope in the debate they will also consider why the thing was put in place in the first case. Look at the nature of the job. Look at even the history of the judges who retired after reaching 70. What happened to them within the next 10 years of retirement? What is their health status? You may find that actually the nature of the job, which takes you away from the rest of society, you live a sedentary life, you are reading, you are in books all the time, maybe it takes a toll on your health as well. I don't know. So if there's that debate, I have no problem with it. But as long as the Constitution had not been amended, it was my duty, and I believe the duty of every citizen, that I abide by it.
My Lord, it goes without saying that you've retired with a wealth of experience, and you've virtually served in almost all arms of government and all spheres of life, from legal private practice to the judiciary to the executive to the legislature. Do you think you've performed to the best of your ability, especially at the height of your service?
Yes. I believe I have given it my all. Wherever I've served, be it as a state attorney, or be it as a minister, be it as a member of parliament for this area, if you ask the people around here, I'm sure many of them will still tell you this man did what he could. And even now in the judiciary, I believe that I have done the best I could have done, not with all the resources I wanted, both human resource and financial resource, but nonetheless, even what was given and what we have been able to do. I ask people to look at the judiciary when I came in, even from the time or the point of view of what we've been talking about, the remuneration of judges and where it is now. I want to see the equipment that has been given judges during my term to do their work. The introduction of the electronic case management system, which I have no doubt, if it is properly implemented, as I said, we are starting it as a pilot project in 16 or 17 courts, but when it is properly implemented and rolled out throughout Uganda, and that may not be within the next 1 year or two, I think we are giving ourselves up to 3 years. Rwanda has done it. In Rwanda now, a case is considered backlogged if it has been in the system longer than 6 months. Here we are still talking of backlog at more than 2 years. I've been to Malaysia, who started the same system. A case is considered backlogged if it is in the system more than 9 months. So it is possible. If Rwanda can do it, Malaysia can do it, we can do it also. Now, it's not immediate, but we have to start working at the planning. This has been done, and the agreement has been signed, it is being implemented. We have been paying money every year. Development, instead of developing, we pay money for rent. Where the Supreme Court is rented premises. Not suited for court work. For example, we don't have cells where to keep prisoners. To have a court which doesn't have where to keep prisoners is very dangerous. Judges use the same staircase as the parties, as the lawyers, and what have you, and it speaks volumes for the security of the judges. So I have finally, and I really say this with sincerity, to get the government, to persuade the government that there is need to commit funds to construct homes for the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeal, which are renting premises where we've been paying close to 10 billion shillings every year. And we have now a commitment, we have a contract to construct the tower for the Supreme Court, a tower for the Court of Appeal, and the judiciary headquarters, which will cost about 100 billion shillings, which is what we pay in a matter of 10 years as rent. It's not sustainable. So I've convinced government right now as I speak. I don't know whether you have been there. The construction is going on. I think they have gone past the first basement of the Supreme Court. These are major developments, and that's why I said within the funds government has allowed, the judiciary has made some steps, and as a result of that, even that motivation, we have seen improvement in the disposal rate of cases, and more cases being disposed. But still not eliminating the case backlog. Yes.
You've said you've improved, but you've not been able to eliminate case backlog. As you're stepping out, what kind of advice would you give to your predecessor to ensure that the monster case backlog?
I have left behind a proposal. We persuade government. We appoint what we call temporary judges. You can appoint either retired judges or lawyers on short-term contracts to deal with backlogged cases only. I saw this was done in Malaysia. They appointed some people, gave them, I think it was 2-year contracts, and dealt with not new cases, but only backlogged cases. And within those 2 years, backlog was eliminated completely. Now, when you have eliminated the old pending case, then now you deal with the incoming cases. So you can tell a judge, now you have this new case. It must be disposed of within the next 6 months or 9 months or whatever. And that's what they have been able to achieve. So that proposal, I asked the jailhouse secretariat, they have written that paper. We have we're in the process of discussing it. So I believe that my successor will brush it up. He's been in it anyway, and see how far it can go. We under the new act, there is going to be established the judiciary fund, under which we are going to be able to attract. I believe we should be able to attract not only the funding from government, but from other development partners, specifically for judiciary work, and we can be able to see how we can do much more within the judiciary with whatever funds we shall have.
Your Lordship, how have you been able to successfully juggle civil service and private business? Because it's no mean feat.
No, I have no private business that conflicts with the work I was doing. Running this thing here, for example, that's done by my wife. Each of the small projects you have seen, the farm and so on, I've got managers. And running a farm or running this in no way conflicts with being a judge, you know. It's not one of those things that will put you in conflict with anybody. But you appoint managers who do that, and you play a supervisor role. Once a month, I will go to the ranch and see what's happening there, or my son will go there. So I have not had I have not run the type of business that would put me in conflict. I have no shareholding with anybody else. I have no business with other people. So I had to give up my private law firm when I was appointed a judge. So
those are you're not going back to KAA?
No.
Okay. And
you after 15 years, I gave it up when the moment I was appointed a judge. They had to calculate my interest and pay me, and I got out. And actually, I've never even entered their offices since.
Your Lordship, do you think remuneration, better remuneration or increased remuneration of judges would stem corruption out of...
No, I have said one thing. Remuneration helps to motivate any worker when you give them better remuneration. And I think there are studies which show a well-motivated workforce produces better results. That's different from a corrupt person. I think I have said a corrupt person, no matter what you pay them, they will go for something else. What we need to do is to, when they are recruiting judges in the Judicial Service Commission, when the president is appointing them, or when parliament is vetting them, to go deeper into the integrity history of the individual that is being recommended for appointment, to make sure that the people who have the tendency for corruption do not find themselves on the bench. There is no two way about it. Because once a corrupt person gets on the bench, it is very difficult to get rid of. One, because the people who pay him a bribe will not talk about it. He will not talk about it. And it is rarely witnessed by anybody else. So we'll hear stories that so-and-so is corrupt, but it is very difficult to prove that corruption. And there are many examples, if you go to the Judicial Service Commission, where allegations have been made, but cannot be made out by evidence. And the law is you cannot even just recommend the removal of a judge without the evidence. Because the Constitution protects a judge. To be able to guard that independence from, again, people who lost a case before you can say, oh, they lost because the other side corrupted you. Really maliciously, because everybody loses a case and finds an excuse for doing so. So the Judicial Service Commission, even where it presents a case for removal of a judge, the judge must be given a chance to defend himself. The president then will appoint a tribunal, which is independent, which will look into the allegations that have been made. The judge is entitled to even have a lawyer defend him, and the case must be proved. And that it's only when a tribunal has been appointed that the president will then suspend the judge. So those onerous provisions in the Constitution were put there to protect the judicial officers. So now the burden is on us, the judicial officers, first of all, to ensure that you live to what is expected of you, and you are not subjected to that type of procedure. But the awareness that has been created in the public now, you know, we have what we call court open days. We encourage people. I have attended some of those things myself in person. And you encourage the litigants, the citizens, to ask questions. So you go there, and someone says, even me now, I have seen the Chief Justice, I've asked the Chief Justice. We are beginning to see people gain confidence and raise bigger issues that were not raised before, because now they fear they can report on us. They can report on a judge, they can report on a magistrate, and I think that is a good development. So some of these complaints, people think, oh, there is now a lot of corruption in the judiciary. For me, I say it is because people now are more empowered to speak out. They may be mistaken, but it's important that the people start talking out. And even that itself acts as a check. When a judicial officer says, I don't want to be the subject of discussion at an open rally, you know, because there's a way this information will go around. So I think those checks, the public's interest in what's happening in the judiciary, the capacity of the public to speak out, the close supervision that I'm sure will continue, will eventually keep the majority, and I really keep saying the word majority because I cannot swear that you not have black sheep here and there.
My Lord, you speak of motivation, but one would say there is no better motivated person in this country than those in the legislature. But time and again, we've had cases of individual legislators engaging in such tendencies.
Well, I will not,
and it bothers the public.
I will not talk about the legislature. I had my time in Parliament, in the 6th Parliament, and in the NRC before. I will really not talk about what goes in the legislature. I haven't been there now, I don't know. I was concentrating on what goes on in the judiciary. But I have also made the point that if I am corrupt, no matter what you pay me as by way of salary or remuneration, you will pay me 10,000 shillings, I will want 20,000. You will buy me a Toyota, I will want to buy a Mercedes. You will build me a 3-bedroom house, I will want to buy 3 or a storied house. If I am that type of person, we are talking of the ordinary citizen who is honorable and wants to make a career in the judiciary. If I want to make a career in the judiciary, and I have left the university, and many of them are very brilliant young people who have left with first class honors degrees, upper seconds and so on, they want to make a career in the judiciary. What does that mean? I want to start as a grade 1 magistrate. I want to build myself and eventually find myself a judge on the Court of Appeal or Supreme Court. If I am looking at the long term, building of my career and profession, those type of people, and they are the majority, will not be too easily taken up by somebody giving him a bribe of 10,000 shillings and so on. There is a magistrate who was forced to resign because he was caught red-handed taking a bribe of 1.5 million. What does that mean, 1.5 million for a career ruined? You know? So we've been talking to our judicial officers. I think the majority of our judicial officers try. They want to make careers. And they are not just going to give up simply because a salary has been increased. I don't believe that. Because you want to build a career. When I left Kampala Associated Advocates, there are many people, friends, who said, how can you leave such a law firm that was prestigious and making money to become a judge? Indeed, at first I refused. When the president of the Law Society wrote to me to accept their nomination, at first I'd refused. But I talked over it with members of my family and other friends and so on. And a point was made that this is not just about money. If you accept to be a judge and you make a decision which is cited, which is quoted, which is criticized, it is quoted in law schools, that is worth much more money than you can make. There are people who make a lot of money, but they are dying for that recognition. I have had the recognition. I have not made the money. Obviously, you cannot compare the being paid 26 million shillings with hearing with the sort of money that my firm have been paid over time. So it's not just all about money. And I'm speaking for those officers who cherish writing a judgment even as a magistrate, and it is referred to when a professor at Makere is writing an article. It is referred to in law school. When you write a judgment and other courts cite it, there is a satisfaction you get, which is not money. So I think that is the majority of our professionals.
My Lord, that kind of value seems to be evaporating out of the fabric of our society, especially the young generation. Probably you should underscore it.
Yeah, but that's why I'm talking about it. The young generation, what are they interested in? Money or a career? And I'm saying there are those who are interested in a career. Because they realize money will come. Yeah, at the end, yes, you have a lot of money, but that recognition is still lacking. I remember when I was appointed a deputy minister, a friend of mine who had been in very high positions and a very wealthy man, we met at the Kampala Club, and he said, but, you know, here's this young man being made a minister, and some of us why can't we even become ministers? We have everything. So it was hurting him. Not really hurting him, but you say, I have everything. I have money, I have prestige and so on. But why is this young man who has nothing being made a minister above me? You know. Likewise, I know the many magistrates who are great ones, would like to make it chief magistrate, would like to be promoted to being judges and so on. And those who are working is what should be, what we should build on. Corruption, yes, but corruption has to be fought by the whole society, wherever it is. In the schools, you have to fight corruption there. You have children bribing to become appointed prefects. You have people buying exams to pass and get grades. When you have bought your way through O-level, A-level in university, and then you get employed in maybe some international organization, will you produce the results? People will see through you, you know? So we have to keep pointing out, and it's a long-term fight, that you are not going to fight corruption and by the switch of the pen. And
Your Lordship, hold it there. We are going to go for a very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja, and today we are talking to the just-retired Chief Justice of Uganda, Bart Magunda Katureebe. The new law gives the unprecedented privilege to a judge to retire with their full benefits, or at least one.
I think it is. I think it is unprecedented in Uganda, but it is not unprecedented elsewhere.
Yes, but the question is, where do I get the motivation to continue working if working after 2 years I'm going to retire with my full package?
Well, you have really put it too simply, that where would I get the motivation
to continue
to
working,
so when I can retire,
do a few 1-2 years,
then you are forgetting what I've been saying, that someone, the majority of the people are looking after career. You are not looking after retirement when you are 25. You are not because are you working for just 20 or 8 million? What a magistrate is getting, what, 3.5 million?
Yeah.
So you are saying someone will retire because he is getting 3 million?
Because they are going to get the 3 million for the rest of their life. So why should they continue working?
I think that is not the right way to look about it. We are looking at when someone has worked and served and got out, how are they retiring today? How are they retiring today? Is there anybody retiring because you will get a pension? There are people who are in better paying jobs but would like to have the title of being a judge. Haven't you seen some lawyers who have moved from private practice to become judges? So I think it is much bigger than that.
But there is a feeling that the way the law was crafted was to reward you for your role in ensuring you upholding the lifting of the age limit.
That's rubbish, because I'm sorry to use the word, but that's rubbish, because that law has been worked on since 1988, when I was Minister of Justice. That's when the judges called me, Chief Justice Wambuzi, to propose that because Parliament had the Administration of Parliament Act, there should also be an administration of the judiciary bill. And this has been on discussions with Minister of Public Service since that time. So it has nothing to do with what you're talking about.
Is there a time when you reflect on some of the issues that you've handled in the judiciary and say, this was a good decision, or this is a decision that I regret?
There's no decision that I regret, because all the decisions I made, I gave reasoned judgment with my reasons. Someone may disagree with my reasons, that's okay, but there's no decision I gave without reasons, and I don't regret any of them. There are decisions that proved controversial. There are decisions that others didn't agree with. But I think that is the nature of the law. You know, so
what do you say of the relationship between the executive and the judiciary? Because there are cases where you've issued court orders and they have been adamantly violated. I'll give you an example. When you required, when the Supreme Court said that the executive should ensure that there is the electoral reforms in 2 years after your judgment in the Mama Mbabazi case, this has dragged on and on and on. Up to now, the few reforms that were brought have never been assented to.
Well, this is what I was saying. It is frustrating. It is disappointing because those recommendations were made in good faith for the good of the country. But you are not going to do somebody else's role because, again, you talk about separation of powers. You have played your role. You have made the recommendation. Somebody else is supposed to enact the law. Somebody is supposed to assent to the law. So let each one play their part. It is disappointing because those recommendations were very important for consideration. We did not say this must be done. We said study this and act appropriately upon it. And if they haven't done it, it is disappointing. But those are some of the steps that, you know, you take one step and one backwards in building a country.
There is a feeling that people that transit from politics to join the bench tag along with their political colors, and these in many way most times influence their decisions.
That may not necessarily be true. Or you may also have people, because when people come, they come with their own thinking, which you may not know. And you may actually find, I could give you examples, but I will not, of people who previously were actually very active in politics and later turned out to be what people say are some of the best judges. So how do you explain that? Why would you say that one, who also was a minister, turned out to be independent, that one also was a minister, is not independent? Because they disagree on
But do you think the Constitution is a final document now, considering that it has gone through several amendments?
Our Constitution is very young, and it is being tested with time. New situations are arising, which were not anticipated. New players are coming on the scene. The challenge, for example, now is you have COVID. Nobody anticipated a pandemic of this nature coming at a time when we have elections. And the debate now is what we do. You have COVID, people are dying out of it. It is killing people all over the world. We are trying to, you have closed schools, you have closed boundaries, you have closed borders, you have closed the businesses, you know, to try and keep people alive. We are going to an election. Someone says, I have a right to hold a public rally. And somebody in science will tell you, if you get a rally with 10,000 people gathered, and 10 of those people happen to be infected, you may actually end up spreading this disease to many more people. So the debate now is, how do you balance the Constitution with a situation that has happened which was not anticipated? And I think that's the debate which is there. So the Constitution must be a living thing, must be a living document to deal with situations the country faces as they come. So I think that is something.
You've said virtually that COVID-19 has tested constitutionalism or the constitution in Uganda. But there is a
It's a debate going on.
Yes, it's a debate going on. But there is, yes, and the debate is now being shaped into towards 2021 general elections. And the Electoral Commission is saying we should have what they call a virtual election where people campaign scientifically or through the media. What is your take on this?
Because you have to look at what is available. What is available is to organize the elections as the Constitution now says, allow open campaigns, allow freedom to go wherever they want. In other words, let's pray that somebody saying, let's pray that COVID will somehow forgive people when they are gathered for a political rally to exercise their political rights under the Constitution. Would that be tenable? Would that be reasonable? I thought if you are a leader, be it in the parliament or in the executive or in the electoral commission or in the political parties, there must be that recognition that there is danger at the door of the country called Uganda, as it is elsewhere. At the same time, we are required to do X, Y, Z. What do we do? And to me, that's the debate that must be engaged in.
So as a former Chief Justice, what do you think should be done to come out of this kind
of... I don't know. I don't know. I'm saying, let us debate what should be done and balance safety of the people of Uganda with their rights to exercise their choice of election. Because if you don't balance it, and you look at the Constitution only in one way, the Constitution says I must attend a public rally, and I will attend a public rally. It doesn't matter whether there is death there or not, I will go. And I don't know whether at the end of the day, when you, as a man, have gone and attended a public rally, and the person next to you coughs and gives you COVID, and you come back home and you pass it to your wife or to your children, you can stand with your head high and say, but at least, even if we are sick, I exercise my political rights. Would you be able to do that? I think that is something that we should have.
You've advised that let us have a conversation, let there be debate. It seems like the Electoral Commission has passed its verdict and it's been...
The last time I had the secretary of the... the spokesman of the commission was saying they have made this their proposals, and they say they are not cast in stone and people can debate them. So at least that's what I thought I had. But I think even if they have made that... I heard Parliament was asking the Minister for an explanation and so on, and some people have suggested Parliament may come in. That's the conversation. I don't know which form it should actually end up with. But at the end of the day, there must be a balancing of the national interest against our rights under the Constitution to have an election.
You've been, over the 5 years, you've been emphatic on some issues in the law, for example, upholding the right, the 48-hour rule for suspects to be held in custody and then presented in court. But time and again, we see authorities violating these. Are you satisfied with the way police and other entities will handle?
No. You see, the reason why we put those provisions there was in the knowledge that there would be people who would misbehave. If we were sure that everybody would behave the way we want, probably there would even be no need for a law, because it would be taken for granted. The reason we put that thing in the Constitution was because we are coming from a situation where people would be arrested during a minister's time and so on, where people would be arrested and even disappear. So we were saying, when someone has been arrested, let him be produced in court within 48 hours. Not for purposes of trial, because everybody recognizes trial means investigation and the prosecution and so on, but so that he may either be released on bail or be remanded in a place authorized by law. So when that is not done, it's a violation. And we have condemned it. There are excuses to try and justify it, but in my view, if the police and others saw why that thing was there, they should respect it. It's in their interest, it's in the interest of the country that should be respected. So that someone is remanded in a place authorized by law where he can then be reached by his family, he can be reached by his doctor, he can be reached by his lawyers. This was because of where we're coming from. And it is emphasized, we keep emphasizing it, that this rule must be respected.
You're stepping out, but one would wonder, has the time come for a younger or perhaps a female CJ to take over the judiciary?
I would say anybody who shows ability for the job, who has the integrity for the job, who has the knowledge of the law for the job, who has the respect for the job, man, woman, young or old, should be appointed. And I'm not going to say yet whether it should be a young person or what, anybody who qualifies. There is no formula. If you had somebody who is in 50, my predecessor, Chief Justice Odoki, was appointed Chief Justice when I was 58, and he served for 12 years. So there's nothing wrong with appointing someone who is in his 50s. It has been done before.
But you see,
I was appointed when I was 65.
But you see, these two constituencies have been very vocal on taking charge. They are probably saying,
let them, you see, it should not be a matter of constituencies. It should be a matter of identifying someone who is able. And those constituencies should champion the cause of someone whom they identify as being able, answering what I have just told you. And whether it's a woman, yes, it still must answer that criteria. You know, because if we go and say, this is the turn of a woman, and you just put there somebody, even if you say maybe they will not do it, but we stand for a woman or a young person, I think as long as that person, woman or child, or not child obviously, woman or young person or man, as long as he answers the criteria of the Judicial Service Commission, then should be appointed on merit.
In your tenure, where you've proposed changes, like for example mediation, dealing with cases through mediation, do you think this has taken root? And if it hasn't, how can the judiciary now take on the mantle from where you stopped to ensure that mediation?
I found in place there was a rule which had been made that when someone files a case in the commercial court, it should be immediately sent for mediation before it is fixed for hearing. We have seen that some parties and some lawyers didn't favor it, and it acted actually as a further delay in the hearing, dispose of cases, because they just did it as a formality. So, okay, goes for mediation 60 days, they don't want the mediation, it does not take place, and it still goes back to court. An idea has been mooted of making it voluntary mediation, encouraging people to voluntary without that mandatory aspect of going for mediation. And also to try in our training of mediators, especially with the help of our partners from the United States, Pepperdine University and others, to train the lawyers to understand and appreciate the value of mediation, which means the parties take a win-win position instead of going to court where you may have a winner take all. So we still have a lot more to do in terms of educating the public about mediation.
But you've proposed specialized courts as a way of lessening case backlog. Don't you think this proposal is a little too late?
Which specialized courts?
For example, a small claims procedure.
Small claims procedure is not a recent... When I was appointed, the small claims procedure was a pilot project in a few courts around Kampala. It succeeded so well that it has now been rolled all over the country. So it's not a new thing that may fail. It has succeeded. In fact, now the demand is that it should be raised from 10 million to more than 10 million.
As we are winding up, you've talked of writing a book. What should Ugandans expect from this book?
When they see it. How can you ask me what they should expect? They will see it.
Are you going to write a biography about yourself? Are you going to write about...
I'll write about myself because that's what I know too well.
Probably Ugandans would like you to paint a picture of what your plan for retirement would be like.
Why should I paint a picture? I have retired. I have a home to go to, you have seen it. I have some businesses to go to. I have told you I will write my book. I have told you I intend to have a consultancy and a mediation. I don't need to write a book to inform Ugandans about that.
Your Lordship, your last word to the Ugandans.
The Ugandans should keep the peace, accept the debate peacefully, accept challenges, but most importantly, keep themselves safe as they keep others safe. Not to engage in anything that endangers the life of somebody else.
Your Lordship, thank you for making time to the checkpoint. We've been talking to the retiring Chief Justice of Uganda, Bart Magunda Katurebe. Thank you for watching Urban TV. Be sure to catch us tomorrow, same time.